Well, greetings, everyone. Welcome to the event. I'm Ian Morrow, the Executive Director of the Pacific Institute for Climate Solutions, and we're thankful that you're here to join us on this kind of Monday morning in person and online. We've got a great online audience, so thank you for joining us if you're not able to be here in person. And I'd personally like to thank Myles Allen for joining us at the University of Victoria. It's his only stop in Canada on a North American visit, and we're very thankful to have you here and very privileged. And for you to share your thoughts on geological net zero and how we can stop fossil fuels from causing global warming, obviously a critical issue for our time, and we've got one of the preeminent thinkers here to share his thoughts with us. And at PICS, we're about partnerships. We're a partnership-driven organization. And we brought this event together with different co-sponsors, including the University of Victoria's Office of the Vice President Research Innovation, Environment and Climate Change Canada, and the Pacific Climate Impacts Consortium. So we're very thankful for those organizations to be part of the event, and they're going to speak about their involvement and just what we're up to here at the University of Victoria. And to start things off in a good way, I'd like to welcome Edna Jack from the Stumminis First Nation, who's part of our finance team at PICS. And she's going to start us in a good way with a land acknowledgement. So over to you, Edna, and thank you for this.
Aitsquail, Haitsapka, Lekwanen, Wasanich, Sanhis, and Esquimalt Mustimuch, Itzen, Al Siayas, Ta Lekwanen, Tamuch, Haitsapka, Siam Siaya. Ohin asa stuminis asa siapowit. Thanking all Lekwanen, Wasanich, Sanhees, and Esquimalt as we work on the Lekwanen territories, we're thanking all respected friends and Haitsapka Aitsqualoan with our good heart and good mind with completing the work today.
And Cynthia Milton, the Associate Vice President Research for the University of Victoria.
Thank you, Edna, for the territorial welcome. And thank you, Ian, for the opportunity. I'm Cynthia Milton, the Associate Vice President of Research at the University of Victoria. It's our great pleasure to help host today's event. As many of you will know, UVic has had many recent successes in the domain of climate action. We have just launched a BSc in climate science. There are many people here who helped start that initiative. We've received a generous donation for a climate scholars internship program. We have a new certificate in climate action. We have a new graduate program in ocean-based climate solutions, and we just received a very large grant from the federal government to the tune of $84 million for our accelerating community energy transition. So UVic has had a lot of recent success, but this is being based on many years of collaboration, and UVic is known for being a good collaborative force, and I think it's because of that history that we are now celebrating PICS 15th anniversary. PICS is housed at the University of Victoria, but it's done in conjunction with UBC, SFU, and UNBC. And it's these kind of collaborations that we hope will make it so that PICS can be and continue to be the convener on climate for the province of British Columbia as we enter into these uncharted territories and need nimble, and resourceful and well thought out answers to the challenges ahead. So thank you for bringing Myles Allen. Thank you so much for your time, and I look forward to the talk.
Thanks, Cynthia. So I'll just give a couple of words of introduction. So I was sitting in a candidacy exam a couple months ago, and it was on the topic of the rainfall and hydrological response to climate change. And I asked the candidate, well, you know, what's the original literature on this? And I kind of did know the answer, but he pointed out correctly that it was Allen and Ingram, 2002, that really set out the physics of the response, the hydrological response to climate change. And then later the same day, I was putting together a presentation on event attribution, and I thought, well, I should go back to the original literature. And sure enough, Allen, 2003, sets out the idea of how we can, so up until that point, you know, when an extreme event happened, people would just say, well, you know, we can't attribute individual extreme events. That paper sets out a framework whereby we can attribute, we can look at changes in probability of extreme events. So that was really key. That set off the whole research area of extreme event attribution. And a few weeks later, I got an email from Myles saying, you know, I'm going to be in Seattle. Maybe I can come to Victoria. So, yeah, I jumped at the opportunity. But those aren't the only areas that Myles has worked in. When I was doing my PhD with him, or my DPhil with him, his main area of work was on attribution of global temperature changes, and he wrote really key papers in that area. But like I said, he worked on a number of what I was thinking at the time, maybe kind of esoteric side projects that turn out to be these really key papers in climate science. And another one of them, or another area that Myles moved into, was looking at the relationship between warming and cumulative carbon emissions. Myles's paper in 2009 was the first paper to set out the idea of a budget on cumulative emissions that we have to keep below if we want to avoid exceeding a temperature target. And that paper, along with other work in the field, was really key on getting the idea of net zero. We have to reach net zero to stabilize climate, which is in the Paris Agreement. You know, more than 60 countries now have net zero targets. So it's an area where we can see a really clear link from climate science to climate policy. So with that, I'll just say that Myles is professor of geography and atmospheric physics, University of Oxford, fellow of the Royal Society, CBE this year. I'll leave it there. I'll hand over to Myles. Thanks.
And it's also worth emphasizing that my first graduate student before I even had a faculty position was one Nathan Gillett. And I believe I did cite the success of his master's project in my application to the faculty position at Oxford. So Nathan, thank you. History comes full circle. It's very great. It's great to be here and great to meet you all and to catch up with old friends. I want to talk about geological net zero, what we originally meant by net zero, because I'm quite concerned that net zero has become a thoroughly confused topic, and in many not very helpful ways. So let me take you back to the late 2000s when we were starting to think about the cumulative carbon budget. I brought along a little visual aid to explain the point. Each of these little lumps of coal represents half a trillion tons of fossil carbon. So if you burnt it and released it all to the atmosphere, that would be almost 2 trillion tons of carbon dioxide. And when we published, and as we all know now, it would also cause 1 degree of global warming. So that's roughly the relationship. When we published those papers, we just finished burning the first half trillion tons. It took us 250 years. So 15 years on, we are now one third of the way through the second half trillion, which will take us to 2 degrees if we release it all into the atmosphere. And over that same period, we had the Paris Agreement on climate change, which committed the world to limit warming to 1.5 degrees, if possible, or pursue efforts to 1.5 degrees, which means, you know, we've got to take away half of what was left, because the remaining budget, or what was the remaining budget back in 2009, of course, is halved if you're aiming for 1.5 degrees rather than 2. So you don't need to be a climate scientist to recognize that we will generate more carbon dioxide by burning fossil fuels than we can afford to dump in the atmosphere if we're to meet the Paris Agreement goals. And that is a very profound, I'm more certain of this than just about anything in climate science, and it has very profound implications. And I think a lot of people in the climate policy space, particularly those going to COPs have yet to really fully grasp the implications of that fact. We're going to make too much carbon dioxide, so we have to work out what we're going to do with it. Just to remind you what Paris agreed, holding the increase in temperature to well below 2 degrees and pursuing efforts to limit the temperature increase to 1.5 degrees. It wasn't explicitly a commitment to 1.5 degrees. It was this sort of hybrid commitment. That's what they agreed on. They also agreed, because a lot of countries were like, where did this 1.5 degrees come from and would it even be possible? They agreed to commission this special report on 1.5 degrees, which I was heavily involved in, which was published in 2018, and had this sort of headline conclusion, and apologies for the rather convoluted wording of this, but reaching and sustaining net zero global anthropogenic carbon dioxide emissions and declining net non-CO2 radiative forcing would halt anthropogenic global warming on multi-decadal timescales. You can always tell with these kind of rather weird sounding sentences that they're the product of a long negotiation through the night at one of these final plenaries. The word halt in particular, we spent a lot of time on. I think we went in with something like stop, but anyway, you can imagine the conversations that were had. But just to explain what, anthropogenic, human-induced, crucially directly human-induced, we'll come across onto that in a minute, and non-CO2 radiative forcing for the non-enthusiasts in the room, that basically just means other emissions, mostly methane. And to show, to bring this up to date, this is from the latest assessment of the IPCC, the sixth assessment report. If we want to halt warming, we need to get net global carbon dioxide emissions down to zero. So the green are sort of below 2 degrees scenarios, blue is 1.5 degree scenarios, and we need also to reduce methane emissions. What we're showing here is net carbon dioxide emissions, emissions minus removals, minus resulting directly from ongoing human activities. And that's a very important, that's what this graph means thing to remember, because as we'll see through the talk, that's not always what people mean by net zero. I will focus on carbon dioxide, just to sort of get it off my chest. Methane does matter. These methane reductions could reduce global temperatures by 0.2, maybe 0.3 degrees over the course of this century. You'll notice they don't go all the way down to zero. They go down by about 50%. But even that reduction in methane has a big impact. But that's it. Once you've reduced methane, you knock a couple of tenths of a degree off global temperatures, and if you're carrying on emitting carbon dioxide, temperatures will keep rising. So the point is that these reductions in carbon dioxide would reduce the rate of global temperature increase by roughly 0.2 degrees per decade. And I'm stressing this because I suspect a lot of the discussion in the forthcoming Conference of the Parties of the UNFCCC, COP28, there's a lot of enthusiasm for focusing on methane. There's a lot of oil and gas involvement, industry involvement in that COP, understandably, given where it's happening. The industry has a positive story to tell about methane, so let's all talk about methane. Let's keep methane in perspective. Yes, it helps, but it's a decade or less of fossil fuel warming when you think about the CO2. So I'm going to focus on CO2. So back to Paris, back to what was agreed at the Paris in the Paris Accords. So as well as Article 2, parties crucially also agreed what it would take. And in Article 4, it was in order to achieve the long-term temperature goal, in order to limit warming, parties agreed to achieve a balance between anthropogenic emissions by sources and removals by sinks of greenhouse gases in the second half of this century. And so the 1.5 degrees report, this didn't mention net zero, but it was sort of understood. I mean, net zero was there in square brackets for a while, but it never made it into the final text. But that was understood, that's what this balance meant. But you'll notice immediately there's quite a lot of ambiguity in this sentence. Anthropogenic emissions by sources and removals by sinks. Interestingly, Canadians will be interested to know that in the French version, it's anthropogenic emissions by sources and anthropogenic removals by sinks. So, and particularly in a bilingual French-English, what's the correct reading of Article 4? Of the Paris Agreement. Anyway, I don't know. Is this a thing in Canada? I mean, do people? Anyway, it'd be an interesting argument to have. Article 4. I mean, you know, but the fact that Article 4 is different in the French and English versions, I find fascinating. Okay. Some people certainly would like to think that this is it. This is Theresa May announcing the UK's net zero by 2050 target, ending our contribution to global warming. She clearly saw the point of net zero as ending our contribution to global warming. Ending our contribution, in the words of the letter she sent around to everybody, ending our contribution to global warming by 2050 can be the defining decision of this generation in fulfilling our responsibility to the next. So I think most people think that achieving net zero will mean ending our contribution to global warming. And my fear is there will be great disappointment if it turns out not to mean that, and I might get blamed. So that's why I feel quite strongly about this at the moment. You know, it's certainly out there. By the way, we beat the French by about 4 days in terms of making a net zero commitment. It's important. You can go to the Net Zero Tracker website, you'll see, find 92% of the global GDP is now covered by some form of net zero target. You can actually look at the Tracker website and discover what these targets are. Some countries, like Canada or the UK, it's in law. Others, like, for example, Russia or China, it's in a policy document and so on. Others, it's more in still in discussion, but countries are, and you can go to the Tracker website and discover, what different, so they give you a sort of traffic light system for, do they have a detailed plan? Is the reporting mechanism, does it cover all greenhouse gases and so on? Notice the UK gets a red for international offset credits in the sense that the UK is not firmly committed not to use international offset credits. So we're a little bit ambivalent on that one, which we'll come back to. You can go to, interestingly, some countries you'll notice on this plot are blue. A few equatorial countries have said that they've achieved net zero already. Gabon, Guyana, I think, is another one. So Gabon in the net zero tracker, correctly, it says that Gabon has achieved net zero. Ungenerously puts in brackets self-declared, which I think is a bit harsh. But anyway, so Gabon, but it's true, it is self-declared. They say they don't have a detailed plan, but hey, they've achieved it already, so maybe they don't need a detailed plan. But it immediately raises the question. So okay, Gabon is a major oil and gas producing nation, but it's achieved net zero. So what's going on here? It actually, flags what the fundamental issue is with understanding what all these net zero targets mean. So sort of apologies to Gabon for sort of singling them out, but it's a nice example of what the challenges are. By the way, I probably could have singled out Canada on that one as well, but we'll come back to that. Although Canada hasn't claimed to have achieved net zero already, so it's not quite as... Okay, to understand the issue, we've got to think about climate policy before net zero, when climate policy was really all about in the words of the Framework Convention on Climate Change signed in 1992, stabilization of greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere at a level that would prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference in the climate system. And I was one of many scientists who then spent a lot of time over the ensuing 20 years trying to work out what that level was. What was the so-called equilibrium climate sensitivity, which would allow you to determine what temperature you would end up at if you were to stabilize concentrations of greenhouse gases at, say, today's level or at 550 parts per million or whatever, and hold them there indefinitely. And this turned out to be an extremely challenging problem. We basically failed to make any progress on it whatsoever for 25 years, much to the sort of embarrassment of the climate community. The sort of essence of net zero was really moving on from that stabilization framework. So let's just talk a little bit about why stabilization was so difficult and why it was how net zero was moving on from stabilizing concentrations. So if you want to hold atmospheric concentrations stable, so the middle panel here is carbon dioxide concentrations in a stylized model. I could have used the UVic model to have made this plot, but I didn't. I used another one, but it would have looked pretty similar, I think. And indeed, there's been a lot of work on this around here. Kirsten Zickfeld, in particular, has done a lot of work on this kind of, what actually happens when you put different idealized scenarios of CO2 into the atmosphere. So this is holding atmospheric concentrations stable actually allows emissions to continue. In order to stabilize concentrations, you have to drop emissions by quite a lot, you know, 60, 70, 80% or so. But then you can carry on emitting. The axis here is in decades, you know, these are years, so each tick is a decade. So many, many decades after the point of stabilizing concentrations, you could carry on emitting a reasonable level of carbon dioxide. You know, 20% or so of our current emissions would be consistent with stabilizing concentrations. But that would not result in stable temperatures. It gives you a gradually increasing temperature, and temperatures increase at roughly 3% per decade, 3% of whatever temperature you're at. And the origin of that, and basically it takes many, many years, centuries, to reach equilibrium, and the long-term equilibrium warming is extremely uncertain. So just that 3% per decade, that means if it's sort of 1.5 degrees, if you stabilize concentrations at 1.5 degrees, over the next century, you'd get another 0.5 degree of warming. That's what 3% per decade would translate into. So you'd end up near 2 degrees. And it would eventually slow down, but who knows where. So that's why stabilization was such a difficult policy focus, because we really couldn't say what the outcome would be if we were to stabilize, because it involved this sort of infinite time prediction. So, by the way, if you're wondering where this 3% per decade comes from, we've called it the rate of adjustment to constant forcing, and because that's what it is. And if we can, you know, if we can write it very simply as the difference between the equilibrium climate sensitivity and the so-called transient climate response. That's the warming you actually get to when you reach doubled CO2 before the system has re-equilibrated. And you've got to, because it's a percentage, you've got to divide it by the temperature you've got to, so divide it by the transient climate response. And it's a rate, so you need to know the time scale of adjustment from by which you go from that to that. And that's the second time scale in the standard IPCC model used for quantifying. But basically, it's the long ocean adjustment time scale. And that's a couple of 100 years or so. So plugging in central estimates of these numbers, 3 degrees for the climate sensitivity, 1.8 degrees for the transient climate response, and roughly 200 years for the slow ocean adjustment time gives you 3% per decade. So that's where the 3% per decade comes from. So it comes from very, very familiar quantities that we already know about. Unfortunately, I think, in many ways, it's a much more important quantity than, say, this rate of adjustment to constant forcing is actually a much more important quantity than the equilibrium climate sensitivity. I mean, you know, in a sense, what we want to know is what's going to happen if we reduce emissions in the relatively short term. You know, in many ways, it's kind of neither here nor there what happens after many centuries, because, you know, I mean, it'll matter to somebody, clearly, but we will be adjusting policy all the time between now and then. So framing everything around this very long-term equilibrium response isn't, I think, particularly helpful. So one of the things I'm very keen on is that we refocus the energy which is devoted in successive IPCC reports to getting better estimates of the equilibrium climate sensitivity, which I think is, you know, great, but we've done that. I think we need to move on to more policy-relevant quantities, like, in particular, this rate of adjustment to constant forcing. You'll see why it's so particularly policy-relevant as we go through the talk. So that's the stabilization response, the dotted lines in this. The difference is, if you actually drop emissions to zero, which are the big, heavy, solid lines here, so this is, you know, again, a stylized scenario where you pump CO2 into the atmosphere, and then after 70 years, you just stop pumping CO2 into the atmosphere overnight, so you have net zero emissions from then on. Concentrations immediately start to fall through natural uptake by the oceans and biosphere. And I put natural here in scare quotes, because of course it isn't exactly natural that CO2 is being taken up because of past emissions, because of the way we've perturbed the carbon cycle. So the question of whether it's natural or not is a little bit a moot point. And that's really important. We're going to come back to that because that has quite major policy implications. And this gentle decline of happens to balance the slow uptake, slow adjustment of ocean temperatures, and gives you no further warming of the Earth's surface. And this was an observation of that sort of, that largely accidental, I believe, although others have argued it's more fundamental, cancellation between this uptake by the oceans and the biosphere and the adjustment of deep ocean temperatures to give you stable surface temperatures on net zero emissions was, you know, a finding that came out of sort of lots of papers. Dave Frame and I first sort of started talking about this in 2005, but all the papers came out in 2009. Many groups reached the same conclusion. So Kirsten Zickvelt at SFU was one of them, and Andrew was involved in that, of course. Damon Matthews, another, so Canada had quite a big role to play in net zero. Malte Meinshausen and Susan Solomon and Pierre Friedlingstein. It was funny how these things happen with, you know, to be honest, Dave Frame and I, to begin with, we weren't even quite sure if this was a very interesting result, because the question we were being asked was, what's the climate sensitivity? So this was kind of a bit of a distraction, as Nathan put it. It was a hobby problem that we didn't really focus on. And it's funny how, if you look back, it took us a long time to realize this is actually an interesting result. Because, you know, you put more CO2 in the atmosphere, you get more warming. So what? You know, sounds rather obvious. But anyway, we got there in the end. So, but to come on to this, this concentrations falling through natural uptake, I mean, this is what we're talking about here. This is CO2 fertilization visible in a set of photographs of a otherwise undisturbed piece of African savanna, and Midgley and Bond modeled this, quantified why vegetation was changing. You can see how, so 1925, 1993, and 2011, you can see how the vegetation is really growing up there, and that's, you know, there's a net flux of carbon into that patch of land, and that a large chunk of that is because of CO2 fertilization, because carbon dioxide concentrations are higher in the atmosphere, and the vegetation there is growing faster. It's not necessarily a good thing, because actually, for a lot of the local flora and fauna, this isn't what they're used to, and it's actually quite problematic for some ecosystems in Africa. But, you know, our biosphere is responding already to past emissions, and we are counting on that response continuing when we say that net zero emissions will be enough to stop global warming. If it weren't doing this, then net zero emissions would just buy us stable concentrations, and it wouldn't stop global warming. So it's very important the biosphere is responding in this way, which of course raises the question of, you know, so who owns this helpful biosphere? Because rather naively, in the 2009 bit, this wasn't a question we really thought about at all. We just said, okay, there's a natural response. That's happening. But for example, if you look at Canada, and I'm sure people do point this out, Canada's forest sink over from the Global Forest Institute over the past 20 years or so was almost a billion tons of CO2 absorption per year. Canada's emissions, 750 million tons of carbon dioxide per year. So if you were, you know, I'm sure nobody in this room is going to tweet this, but the point is Canada net zero already? Well, no, okay, please, calm down. You can see how, unless you're pretty careful how you define net zero, you could easily end up saying, oh, well, wait a minute, we're already done. And then if everybody were to use a definition of net zero where you were counting all your natural sinks against ongoing fossil fuel production, you'd end up with a situation where the most net zero would achieve would be stabilization of concentrations, and it wouldn't stop global warming. So this is my concern at the moment, is that expectations have been raised that net zero will be enough to stop global warming, and yet we've left ourselves with a definition, with a sort of definitional ambiguity about net zero, which actually means there are definitions of net zero out there that wouldn't stop global warming, even if everybody did them, and even if all the accounting was perfect. So, I mean, to sum up, this is the problem. Back in 2009, we counted all carbon uptake, and we weren't the only ones. I mean, all these different groups that were doing this counted all carbon uptake that was a response to past emissions that would happen, that was happening without any immediate human intervention, was just because plants were growing faster and that sort of thing, and the oceans were absorbing more just because of the concentrations of gradients of CO2. We counted all that as natural. UNFCCC rules allow countries to count carbon uptake as a negative emission and potentially sell it on the offset markets if it takes place on so-called managed land. And suddenly, of course, all land is managed. And you can, if you want to, in Europe at least, you can buy carbon neutral petrol, which has been rendered carbon neutral by protecting and restoring forests. This is this is Shell, needless to say, but other big fossil fuel companies are available, as they say on the BBC. I'm just, this happens to be an example. But one of Shell's competitors, BP, is also going very heavy on nature-based solutions in their net zero strategy. This is focused on the land biosphere and the issue of managed land, but we're seeing papers appearing. I saw one appeared last year talking about the monetary value of blue carbon. So it's only a matter of time before we have people saying, well, okay, now I've got a managed ocean and I'm going to take credit for that and sell it as an offset. You may already be able to do this. In fact, you probably talk to Andrew, he'll get rid of some carbon for you. Okay, anyway. But the point is, great that we're getting rid of carbon, great that the natural world is getting rid of carbon for us, but we've slightly lost track of what we originally meant by net zero in terms of what it'll take to stop global warming. So here we are. This is where we're at based on Global Carbon Project numbers. This is the present day, 35 odd billion tons going into the atmosphere every year from fossil fuel and industrial activity in general. Land and sort of the combination of land and nature-based solutions is at the moment putting carbon into the atmosphere, roughly 5 billion tons of CO2 per year, that's deforestation and so on. But we've already got those negative bars there, which I've called passive uptake, meaning it doesn't require any human intervention. And they're divided in two. The hatched bits in those are the components that would continue, and this is a fairly informal estimate. I think we need to drill down on this rather better. The component of uptake by the land and the component of uptake by the oceans that would continue even if we stopped concentrations rising in the atmosphere. So there's two parts to this biosphere uptake. There's the response to the fact that we're driving up concentrations, and there's the response to the fact that concentrations are already high. Both of these result in more carbon dioxide being taken up by the oceans and biosphere. So if you sort of maxed out on UNFCCC definitions, you could, if you were a sort of single agent running the planet, claim to achieve net zero immediately by just reducing fossil fuel emissions, by balancing to roughly a bit over half what they are today, balancing your land use emissions with nature-based solutions, and relying on that passive uptake continuing for a year or two, which it probably would. So you could sort of get to net zero instantly if you were really quick, okay, with only a 50% or so reduction of fossil fuel emissions. Of course, if you were to do that, concentrations would stop rising in the atmosphere, and so the land and ocean uptake would immediately start to reduce, because the solid part of those bars is there because the system is going up so fast, the concentrations are going up as fast as they are. So quite quickly, you'd end up with a situation where within a few decades, I should say, you'd end up in a situation where concentrations are stable in the atmosphere, but you're still burning fossil fuels, and it just so happens that the rate at which you're burning fossil fuels is balanced by natural uptake by the land and the oceans, because we're at a concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere that's much higher than it was in pre-industrial times. And by the way, I've added in here, just sort of hypothetically, including in that those land-based emissions, we'd also have to include in that Earth system feedbacks, things like forest fires, for example, where you're getting more carbon going into the atmosphere from the biosphere just because the world is warmer and drier than it was. So that's the ongoing passive uptake by the biosphere and the oceans due to cumulative emissions, which would persist for many decades. So we both can rely, and we are relying on that continuing for many decades after we reduce emissions. So what it actually takes to stop global warming is to go beyond that. And in particular, we would have to balance remaining production of CO2 from burning fossil fuels, whatever it is, with active removal of carbon dioxide from the active carbon cycle and reinjection underground. So that's engineered removals. That's the only long-term durable compensation for generating carbon dioxide from burning fossil fuels. If we get to this state, which is what I'd call a durable net zero, where land-based emissions are balanced by land-based removals and geological emissions are balanced by geological removals, so it's everything's like for like, we would still see passive uptake by the oceans and biosphere continuing, and that results in this 3% per decade reduction at the atmospheric carbon dioxide loading. That 3% is now 3% of cumulative emissions to date. So it's quite a substantial number. By the time we get to 1.5 degrees, 3% per decade of 1.5 degrees will be minus almost 10 billion tons of carbon dioxide per year. So about a quarter of our current emissions. This is a significant term in the budget, and we are absolutely counting on it. And the problem we have is that with a clever enough accountant, and many of my grad students are discovering there's a lucrative career in this for them, you could count all three of these as net zero. Yeah? And if you go to McKinsey, they'll probably find a fourth one as well. Sorry. Other big bad accounting firms are available. So this is, I feel this is rather where we're at. I hope you're all familiar with the great work of literature, The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, but as you probably know, there was one of the scenes in it where they're calculating the answer to life, the universe, and everything, and the computer thinks away for many thousands of years and finally comes up with the answer 42, and they realize they forgot to say what the question was. And I feel, we're in this situation with net zero. Everybody's agreed the answer is net zero, but what was the question? And that's where we're at. And this is why I don't think redefining net zero would be a good idea, because it's just not going to happen. But this is why the phrase geological net zero is one that I'm starting to talk about a lot, because that's an essential component to net zero, which is this balance between ongoing production of CO2 from geological sources with restoring carbon to the geosphere through capture and storage. And we see in the scenarios that meet the goals of the Paris Climate Agreement, this is, just taking the red line here is the production of CO2 from industrial processes in Paris compliant 1.5 degree scenarios. You can see it goes down. We do burn a lot less by about 2/3 to 3/4 over the next few decades by mid-century, but it doesn't go remotely close to zero. And of course, we do that burning less by replacing with renewables and so on, but we also store a great deal more back into the geosphere. That's capturing either at source, as in this little picture here, or recapturing from the atmosphere and reinjecting that carbon dioxide back underground. And if you see in this big picture scenario, the heavy lifting of getting us to net zero, compensating for ongoing production of CO2 from burning fossil fuels, is done by that blue line, by geological storage. There is a role for reversing deforestation and nature-based solutions. That's the green line, but it's just quite close to the zero line. There's a limit to what we can expect the biosphere to do. And even more importantly, we have this natural uptake, or passive uptake, perhaps I should say, by the oceans and biosphere that nobody's agreed what it is and causes massive confusion in accounting for biosphere uptake by nature-based solutions at all. If a forest I mean, in the latest guidance that I was reading for the UNFCCC, they define a negative emission against a baseline that if you had a region which was being deforested on the one hand, but the remaining trees were growing faster because of CO2 fertilization on the other, so that if you measured carbon flux into that region, it was zero. If you were to stop the deforestation, you'd be able to count that as a negative emission. So the recommended accounting rules that are being discussed in preparation for COP28, I don't know where these have come from and who's written them, but I mean, it sort of appeared as the sort of working document for the UNFCCC, would continue to allow essentially avoided deforestation to count as a negative emission. It means if everybody can happily fly around the world paying somebody else to stop some deforestation, we're not going to stop using fossil fuels. This is why the existence of these loopholes is why there's a sort of $2 a ton button you can press on, you know, when you buy your plane ticket, which supposedly neutralizes your flight. And of course it doesn't. It may be serving, it may be doing many good things, but it's not actually compensating for you causing global warming. That is what does. Geological net zero means that if you're generating carbon dioxide from fossil sources, you're putting it back underground. So what it takes to stop global warming is in fact extremely simple. We currently put back into the Earth's crust 0.1% of the CO2 we generate, 1/1000th of the CO2 we generate from burning fossil fuels. We need to increase that fraction to 100% and we're done. There you are. Straightforward. Sorry?
Easy.
I didn't say easy, I said simple. Okay, it is simple. And that's really important because it's important because it isn't sort of widely understood that that is what the challenge is. One of the implications of this, and to come back to these lumps of coal, we need to do this soon if we're going to meet the goals of the Paris Climate Agreement. We're still burning fossil fuels at a rate of 35 billion tons of CO2 per year. We need to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming before the world stops using fossil fuels. That's something I like to say again and again and again because it has very profound implications. Why am I asserting this with such confidence? Well, if I look at so-called fossil elimination scenarios in which we stop using fossil fuels altogether, there's two of them in these sort of representative scenarios from the 1.5 degrees report. There's more in the most recent IPCC report, but they all share the same characteristics. Either we see an immediate 30% reduction this decade in primary energy demand, that's energy demand, not fossil fuel demand, or we see absolutely massive deployment of bioenergy later on this century. So if you don't believe, well, the first one isn't happening, and we've got empirical evidence that it's not happening, and if you talk to the carbon cycle modelers and those who know what we need the biosphere for, like biodiversity and food production and so on, they don't want that to happen at all. You're left with these other two scenarios, P2 and P3, both of which involve fossil fuel use, either with carbon capture or not, continuing right throughout this century. So we need to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming before the world stops using fossil fuels. Which is why I find this kind of statement from the UNEP GAP report, only an urgent system-wide transformation can avoid climate disaster. You know, what they should have said was, only an urgent system-wide transformation or rapid scale-up of geological CO2 storage can avoid climate disaster. It's a little bit more of a mouthful, but I would assert is slightly more honest about the situation we're in. This has very important practical implications. One of these individuals has a plan to stop the fossil fuels they sell from causing global warming by 2050. Anybody know which one?
Well,
of course, it's the woman. Interestingly, yeah, the only woman who's CEO of an oil and gas company, and their plan is that they will be putting CO2 back into the Earth's crust at the same rate that they are selling CO2 embedded in their products, so not just their own operations. So Darren Woods has generously offered to make his own operations net zero by 2050. So what? He should have done that already. Bale Sawan and Bernard Looney are both saying they're going to get to net zero with some really complicated combination of accountants and nature-based solutions. And it just doesn't stack up. The only one who's got a simple plan that stacks up, in my view, is Vicky Holt. I'm sure there's aspects of the plan that we can quibble with, but at least there's a plan. The problem is, the only reason she can have a plan is the Inflation Reduction Act is currently paying, so the US, and I know I failed to find a relevant picture for Canada, I'm sure you've got a similar one, and indeed you, through your taxes, are paying for carbon capture and storage. So we have a situation at the moment that the oil and gas industry is making, if you think about the sort of revenues of the oil and gas industry last year, they were of the order of $13 trillion. In 2019, pre-COVID, it was around $6 or $7 trillion per year. And so their costs of production haven't changed very much. So that difference is, you know, $6 or $7 trillion a year, which would be enough actually to pay for the capture of all the CO2 from all the products they generate. So the money's there, and yet somehow the taxpayer is meant to pay for this. This is the thing I think we need to start to challenge. And I gather there's a conversation going on in Canada about taxpayers paying for CCS. And I absolutely think, I very much welcome the fact that countries are finally getting serious about geological CO2 storage. So I don't want to disturb that consensus that we need this technology. We absolutely need this technology. But I do question whether we need the taxpayer to pay for it. Here's an alternative. How to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming without putting the taxpayer on the hook for doing it. This is a sort of schematic of our current economy. We have extractors of fossil fuels. The blue arrows refer to embedded carbon dioxide. They produce fuels, they pass them on to refineries or factories, they make them into products which go to consumers, and it all ends up in the atmosphere. So we have industrial point sources at the moment in Europe are the only ones who are really affected, and in Canada, are really the only ones who are affected by climate policy because we have emission trading systems and things. They have to pay for their emissions. So they're a bit grumpy. Consumers are confused. The atmosphere is sweating. The geological storage operator here is somebody who set up a business to put CO2 back underground, but you can see they're sad and lonely because there's no incentive for anybody to really buy their services. The government is fast asleep, and the extractor importer is laughing all the way to the bank, and they really are right now making out like bandits. So we introduce something we call a carbon take-back obligation. This is a requirement on the extractor importer to produce evidence that some CO2, some fraction of the CO2 embedded in the products they sell has been stored safely back in the geosphere, back underground. So that extractor importer would have to buy a certificate from the geological storage operator, which might, of course, be another division of the same company, I don't care how they organize it, to prove that they are starting to get rid of the CO2 associated with both their activities and the products they sell. So what happens? Well, that CO2 comes from, initially, industrial point sources. That would be the first place to go and find it. Nice, pure CO2. It's much cheaper to capture CO2 when it's concentrated than recapturing it from the atmosphere. So the industrial point source is intrigued because suddenly they can sell their CO2 instead of being penalized for generating it. Consumers wouldn't notice because it's a small fraction. The atmosphere is still sweating because we're still putting lots of CO2 into the atmosphere. But the geological storage operators are now happy because they have a business. They have a case for doing what they do. The government has its nerd glasses on because it's learning how to do this. And monitoring, reporting, and verification is going to be crucial for carbon management in the second half of this century. We have to start doing this now because you don't want cowboys injecting CO2 saying, yeah, we've got rid of the CO2, give us a certificate, and it turns out it's leaking out sort of 100 kilometers down the road. So it'll take us decades to develop the systems we need to do carbon management safely. The extractor importer, of course, is very cross because they have a new cost which they didn't have before. But as I say, I don't really feel that sorry for them at the moment. Right, on we go. We scale up the stored fraction. We now get to the 2030s, 2040s. We start to run out of CO2 from point sources, and we're having to capture it from the atmosphere. So we've got a direct air capture operator has appeared in the picture. The industrial point source is happy because they're selling their CO2. The consumers are starting to be sort of intrigued. The atmosphere is feeling a bit better. Geological storage operator is doing really well. The government is still feeling pretty good about things. And the extractor importer is perhaps feeling less bad about it because they can start to see how their future will evolve in this net zero carbon managed world. Finally, we get 100% stored fraction. The industrial point source is happy because they're selling all their CO2. The consumers are happy because we've stopped global warming. The atmosphere is breathing a sigh of relief. The geological storage operator is still making loads of money. The government is feeling awesome because it stopped global warming. And the extractor importer has saved the planet.
Question. Will this be on the PICS website? Some of us are trying to take pictures from back here and we're losing the detail that we
need. Yeah, that's a real shame because I love the emojis. yeah, okay, the slides will be provided. Okay. So one thing which everybody gets very anxious about at this point is, well, what about the trees? What's going to happen? If we insist it's got to be geological, where's the incentive going to be to preserve our forests? And I've got a little suggestion on that one. It's true that carbon offsetting promises to channel vast new resources into forest protection. And everybody in the forest protection business is really excited about this. And so they get very cross with me when I start saying, you know, no, that's not what we meant. That's not net zero, certainly the way we meant it. Only geological storage actually compensates for fossil fuel use. So who is actually going to pay for ongoing protection of the biosphere, which we need to keep taking up that carbon in the second half of this century? Well, here's a hint. I pointed out to you that the amount we need the biosphere to take up after net zero scales with cumulative carbon dioxide emissions. The more we put in, the more we need the biosphere to be taking out after we get to net zero just to keep temperatures stable. And we know exactly where that carbon's come from. A lot of it's come from the UK, because we started burning this stuff well before anybody else did. So the dependence on biospheric uptake after the date of net zero scales very directly with cumulative emissions up till that date. So I think we should start a conversation in the UNFCCC about countries with high historical cumulative emissions having a specific responsibility that's nothing to do with offsetting their ongoing emissions, but everything to do with the fact that they've just put a whole lot of carbon into the atmosphere that shouldn't be there to protect the biosphere after the date of net zero. Just to put some numbers on that, increasing the natural uptake for durable net zero by 3% per decade. In the case of the UK, by mid-century, that'll be 250 million tonnes of CO2 per year. So the amount of carbon dioxide that we in the UK are requiring the world to get rid of after the date of net zero is almost our current emissions. And that's just because we've been emitting so much for so long. And Canada should be lobbying for this because you're going to be the ones providing that service. So quite logically, you would be charging the UK for the benefit of mopping up the UK's emissions. This is nothing to do with fossil offsetting. This is just, you know, who pays what for this service that we need the biosphere to provide after the date of net zero. Are we getting there? Well, we need to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming before the world stops using fossil fuels. If you remember nothing else from this talk, remember that. And, you know, the COP28 president, Sultan Al-Jaber, is making noises in this direction. You'll notice that when he's giving speeches, he's emphasizing always we need to phase out fossil fuel emissions. And he will go further and point out this does not mean fossil fuel use. We've got to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming. This is essentially what I'm saying. Here it is. Just to quote another Saudi gentleman from Sultan Al-Jaber, of course, UAE, but this is from the same part of the world. Sheikh Yamani, back in the 70s, pointed out the Stone Age didn't end because we ran out of stones. The Oil Age won't end because we run out of oil. And I need you to realize that global warming must end before we stop using fossil fuels. And that means a fundamental rethink in how we go about solving the problem. Thank you.
Wow, what an incredible talk, and I understand, Myles, why you needed the emojis to work. It was a critical conversation about the setup for this talk and taking us through not only redefining the problem of net zero and the definition, but actually through to the solutions of how we get back on track. What an incredible opportunity to be here with Myles Allen, so thank you. To the audience, who's got questions? We've got a bit of time here. Go ahead. I'll bring the mic to you.
Thanks very much. I'm a little skeptical, I guess, in our ability to store underground and how much energy it takes to do that. this carbon capture and storage stuff we have going on over in Squamish at the moment. I mean, the governments will throw billions or millions and millions of dollars in subsidies at that. But it won't, at the other hand, regulate and stop us buying half-ton trucks and SUVs, which are primarily responsible for our BC, for example, and Canada and North America's uptake in transportation-related emissions, because that's what we buy today, 70% of our vehicles are that. Around the whole notion of net zero, again, we in Canada, and especially in Alberta, and the federal government is pushing along the same line, is that if we can reduce, or they're committing to net zero from our oil production and gas production by 2050. Something like 90% of our oil is exported, natural gas similarly, and the emissions, 90% of the emissions are when they're burned, not when they're produced. So we're being sold a message here in Canada that we can get to net zero when 90% of our emissions aren't accounted for, because our emissions are products, at least they're burned offshore. And that, to me, is complete hypocrisy. But that's this whole thing of net zero. And it's just like sustainability was a big word 25 years ago, and it's totally lost its meaning, too. And I think net zero is in the same boat. And with our forest, you mentioned about forest sequestration. In Canada now, our forests emit more carbon than they consume by a large measure because of the rapid increase in forest fires that we're sustaining.
Yeah, so lots of thoughts in there. But just picking up on the exports issue, I mean, who's responsible for getting rid of the CO2 is a really thorny one, and something that, you know, we need a UNFCCC process to resolve. But in the end, the collective producers and users of fossil fuels, we need to establish the principle that they've got a responsibility to get rid of the CO2. So whether the CO2 is got rid of by the producer or at the consumption end, ultimately doesn't matter for the planet. So if Canada's exporting oil to the US, and then, I mean, this is where, I mean, so one thing Canada could do on this would be to acknowledge the geological reality here and clarify, it's not really a new target, but it's a clarification of the net zero target that it means geological net zero. So you're not gonna, you know, dodge around on this, but that would be a very helpful thing, just to clarify this is what you mean. And I think it'd be worth challenging your politicians if they won't clarify it. Does that mean they intend to take advantage of all these loopholes? You know, so, I mean, I would imagine that it would be quite difficult to persuade your federal government to immediately clarify that what we meant by net zero was geological net zero, and this is what it means. But but just that conversation about, well, why not make that clarification, I think would itself be helpful, because it would, you know, reveal how perhaps some people still haven't really grasped that this is actually what we need to do. And then, having committed to geological net zero on Canada's territorial emissions, you're then in an incredibly strong position to challenge your trading partners to do the same, notably the United States. So if Canada's committed to geological net zero, you know, at the moment the United States claims to have a climate progressive government, why haven't they committed to geological net zero? And if they do, then, you know, the whole of North America would, you know, once Mexico joins in, become a geological net zero region, and then it'd be pretty straightforward to manage, you know, where carbon is being brought up and where it's being put back, and it wouldn't, the fact that, you know, carbon's being traded within that region would be entirely manageable. But yes, obviously, it's not going to solve the problem if only one country commits to geological net zero, but some country's got to be the first. And one really interesting thing here is that, you know, if we're going to stop global warming, within 20 years, every country will have had to have acknowledged we need to get to geological net zero. So, you know, you've got a place in history available here.
So, Myles, we've got a question online. Please speak to the technological potential for carbon capture, storage, and cost and timeline. So how we kind of advance this technologically.
So, sure. So the resource capacity is very like the question of actually fossil fuel resource availability. Nobody seems to quite know how much fossil fuels we've got, because it all depends on what we're prepared to pay for them. And the same goes for carbon dioxide storage capacity. Unfortunately, we haven't had the same kind of incentives to identify carbon dioxide storage capacity underground as we've had to find new fossil fuels. But I put it to you that if the fossil fuel industry had a licensing requirement, they had to find storage capacity to balance their remaining production, they'd find it pretty fast. You'd need strong monitoring to make sure that it was real and they really were putting CO2 back where they could. But we can do all that. The industry knows how to do that. It's perfectly possible to establish, if carbon dioxide is put underground, whether or not it's staying there. So I would put it that, in a sense, that should be the industry's problem, is finding this resource and driving down the cost of exploiting it. And you know, what will it cost? Well, I think the lessons of the fracking revolution, which wasn't great for climate, or you can argue about what, but if the industry has enough of an incentive to do something big involving the Earth's crust, it generally can do it pretty fast. So and drive down costs remarkably. So you know, at the moment, carbon capture and storage is sort of at the, if you have a point source, it's at the $70 or $80 a ton. If you don't have a point source, it's more up at the several hundred dollars a ton level. I mean, in context, that's less than natural gas prices have fluctuated in the UK over the past year. So I mean, it's not as if these costs are completely out of the range of what we're willing to pay for fossil fuels. So. But you know, I think the industry needs incentives to drive the costs down, and I don't think throwing subsidies at them is a great way to do that. You know, I think it needs, if it was a licensing requirement, they'd find low-cost ways of doing it. If it's a matter of ask the federal government for money to do this activity, you're going to make it as expensive as possible.
Thank you. So we've hit 11 o'clock. If you need to go, that's okay. And we're going to keep going with the conversation, though, because I think we've just started. So if you have a time commitment, feel free to kind of leave. But for those of you that want to stay and have this conversation, let's do this. So over to you, and I'll give you the mic.
Thanks, Myles. Yeah, David Moffat. I run a climate impact fund. And two things have kept us from investing in geological projects. And the previous comment kind of alluded to them. One is the technological risk, particularly, and that's less on industrial point sources, but it still exists. And on DAC, it's huge, and how that's going to scale. And the other one really relates to the price of carbon, because frankly, we can get good returns for our investors, both in terms of emissions and in terms of financial returns, from other kind of projects, lots of methane destruction projects on farms, et cetera. And we just don't know what the price is going to be when it comes to geological sequestration. And the costs, as you pointed out, are really high compared to what's there now. So, you know, I guess I'm kind of wondering your solution. It sounds like a regulated one of industry, you shall do this. And that would be great. I just don't see a lot of movement on that in the short term, in at least, you know, the countries that I work in, which are primarily the US and Canada.
So I don't see this happening on a significant scale until it's regulated. If we wait for a carbon price to do this, it's waiting for Godot. It's never going to, you know, they've had marginal carbon prices in Sweden of hundreds of dollars a ton for actually some time. And no action on CCS. I mean, they're just starting some CCS projects now with very specific incentives to do it. So, you know, we've got to, you know, this is one thing which we're struggling with in the EU, is everybody thinks the European emission trading system is going to deliver everything. We've got very strong empirical evidence it's not going to deliver large-scale carbon capture and storage. So the reaction to that is to bolt on subsidies on top of the ETS, and investment guarantees and so on to make some carbon capture and storage projects happen. Well, that means the taxpayer is taking all the risk, and the taxpayer doesn't actually have that much money in Europe. And so, you know, there's very few of these projects are happening. It's never going to scale until somebody with pockets as deep as the fossil fuel industry actually have an incentive to do it. And that's why I think a regulation is the only option. So we still, that's not to say we don't need all of these other projects to get down emissions in the short term, because of course the faster we can reduce emissions, the more time the industry has to transition to geological net zero, but we still need to require them to do it. So as I see it, this is a backstop measure that we need to acknowledge this industry is going to continue. It's going to continue past the date of net zero, so we need it to clean up its act. And so I don't think this is, and we need investors to, once that, you know, once the prospect of regulation even becomes real, it all becomes investable. Because suddenly it's like, oh my God, people are going to need these certificates in order to buy fossil fuels in 10 years' time. That becomes a really good investment.
Who's next in person here? Here we go.
Thank you so much for your talk. I'm really interested in your fossil fuels. A person today can go and take their car to a garage and have it converted into compressed natural gas, and what comes out the tailpipe is a lot less carbon dioxide. So as Mark Jacquard said, do not let perfection get in the way of good. So can I hear you on that?
Yes, I mean, that's a good line, but I'd say also, you don't let, you know, modest progress make you think you've solved the problem. So, I mean, you know, and I think that's the difficulty we have, is that we're still, if all we had to do was the old stabilization target and reduce emissions by 50 or 80%, we could probably do that by just using fossil fuels more efficiently. I mean, we waste fossil fuels on such a colossal scale at the moment. We could just, you know, tighten things up a bit, do things a bit more sensibly, we'd probably get most of the way there. But that 25% of emissions, many of which are not, you know, they're things like producing ammonia, producing steel, aviation. That's the reason I've got a plane on there, you know. These are activities that will still be using fossil fuels, I guarantee you, in 30 or 40 years' time. And, you know, the aviation industry loves to talk about using sustainable aviation fuel, but you actually look at the numbers and what they can do, it's just irrelevant compared to the scale of our use of fossil fuels in aviation. So, yes, there are going to be other ways to reduce emissions, very possibly cheaper ways to reduce emissions in the short term, but that doesn't change the fact that we still need our remaining fossil fuel use to be geologically balanced by the date of net zero.
Incredible talent in the room. We've got Andrew Weaver here with a question.
I promised Myles I wasn't going to ask any questions.
But you couldn't resist it. I knew you'd crack.
I wanted to address and get your thoughts on the policy options that you discussed at the very end with respect to regulatory versus subsidies. And the reason why I'm raising this is, from a practical point of view, if government were to regulate a requirement for CCS, industry would rightly suggest the following: our capital is very mobile, we're not going to invest here, we're going to move to another jurisdiction. And on top of that, they would use the argument, and I say this as somebody who was lobbied by them all the time, that in fact it will just pass the cost along to the consumer. Therefore, we need your help in order to make this palatable for the consumer, because we don't want to pass the cost along. And also, if you do this to us, we're going to go invest in Indonesia. How do you, I mean, I agree with you about the regulatory environment is the only way to get it to happen, but what about initially the notion of tax credit or subsidy to get them going?
I mean, look, if it gets a few plants built so we have a better handle on what this is all going to cost, great. I'm really excited and delighted that finally we have some action on geological CO2 storage, it seems, through the IRA, through the programs that are happening in Canada, and maybe even through some initiatives in the European Union, which has been pretty hopeless on this over the past 20 years. But so that's all a good thing. But I'm just, you know, I do think we need to be challenging this presumption that, you know, we'll do it if the government pays for it forever, because the government can't afford. There's no way we can get beyond essentially the demonstrator plant stage with taxpayer, you know. And people say these are commercial scale projects. Well, you know, not compared to the size of the fossil fuel industry, they're not. And there's just absolutely no way any taxpayer anywhere has the resources to do that. Only the industry can do it. And they will only do it if there's a regulation that requires them to do so. So this argument that, oh, we'll just go off elsewhere, well, it depends on how the regulation's implemented. In Canada, for example, you could make it a requirement on all fossil fuels that are used in Canada. You have to prove that a certain amount of CO2 has been stored, and that you start that CO2 percentage at a pretty low level. So if it's, you know, if it's a 10% storage requirement by the early 2030s would be invisible in fossil fuel prices compared to weekly fluctuations. Of course, people will scream about it and go on, but you know, it actually wouldn't have that much impact on the economy because it's only 10%. And they'd be able to largely discharge that with CO2 that's readily available from point sources. So
that's a brilliant suggestion because it actually mirrors our low carbon fuel standard policy, which is actually lowering the carbon content of fuel over time.
Yep. It is a low carbon fuel standard. If I was in California, I'd call it something different. I wouldn't call it carbon take back obligation. I'd just say it's a low carbon fuel standard applied to all fossil fuels. And you just keep it going down to zero. And that's it. And the point is, yes, the cost will be passed on. How much of the cost will be passed on is where I sort of, you know, it depends. If there's fossil fuel executives in the room, I'd kind of be a bit, oh, yeah, sure, you'll be able to pass the cost on, don't worry about it. But in reality, if we do well at developing alternatives, they won't be able to pass the whole cost on because that'll just drive down demand. In the end, the industry charges for fossil fuels what it can get away with. It doesn't charge anything remotely connected to what they actually cost to produce. So if you add an extra cost to the cost of production, in the decadal timescale, it probably won't make any difference at all to actually what they're selling the stuff for. What would make a big difference to fossil fuel prices in 20 years' time would be an extraction ban. So, you know, at the moment, we've got the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty advocates saying, let's block any new licensing of new fossil fuel extraction in all the countries we can get access to. That would concentrate supply into countries like Saudi Arabia and Russia, which have shown no interest in fossil fuel non-proliferation treaties, and result in probably much, much higher prices in 20 years' time. And I would imagine geopolitical chaos and various other things. So, you know, I actually think, you know, we need to regulate the industry, but simply banning new extraction is a really bad idea.
What an interesting conversation here at the University of Victoria, and to honor the people that aren't here, we've had a solid over 100-person online presence throughout the morning, so thank you for those people who are online. And there's a couple questions here talking about the large-scale adoption of carbon capture storage technologies and whether or not that inadvertently takes away from the importance of actually reducing our use of fossil fuels.
One thing, and I recommend, there's a paper led by Stuart Jenkins, a grad student in Oxford, looking at precisely this question of how do you balance incentives to reduce emissions and incentives to drive up the stored fraction. And what he shows in that paper is if you rely exclusively on a carbon take-back obligation, you end up with a ridiculous amount of storage and unfeasible rates of storage in the 2040s. So that's a bad idea. We still need policies to drive down emissions. Absolutely. This is a backstop policy to add to the policies we've already got. The one thing our policies at the moment are not delivering is carbon capture at a scale that's relevant to the problem. So we need a specific targeted regulation to deliver that. And that's the point here. You know, we can't take this. This shouldn't allow us to take our foot off the pedal. Maybe it's not a great analogy, but on driving down emissions in the short term, that's incredibly important. But we have to recognise that's not going to deliver geological net zero.
Thank you. Anybody else in the room here?
Thanks, it was a really great talk. I liked your idea about making people responsible for cumulative emissions and the idea that some biosphere value could come into
that. By the way, health warning, like, that was kind of something I thought of in preparing for these talks. This is kind of new, but it's exciting, isn't it? The idea that Britain owes Gabon, that's a whole lot of money. Anyway.
I just thought it sort of came to mind, relates to that, whether even for that, whether you should have a higher threshold for biological storage in terms of permanence to what's being set now for more general offsets, even for that, whether we should be thinking at geological timescales rather than like 100 years that they're currently setting at.
Yeah, I think there's no question any claim that an activity compensates for generating CO2 from burning fossil fuels, the storage timescale of that activity, whatever it is, has to be millennia. I mean, otherwise you're just kidding yourself. And I mean, you know, so I am worried about the fact that in the sort of accounting discussions, the accountants are all over this, like a rash. And you know, these sort of, 100 years is good, 100 years is permanent. So where does that come from? No, it's not. And of course, if you, yeah, so I totally agree with you. I suspect that, you know, in the end, we will establish that the only options available, I wouldn't want to close off options at this stage. We just have to establish the principle that if you have a removal option that you claim is geological, it's got to be geological timescale storage. And you got to, and also the other side of it, it's got to be geological timescale storage without relying on somebody else doing something. So that's the problem with, you know, if you store carbon in the biosphere, you may well have assurances that, you know, no, they're not going to deforest another part of the country to grow beef instead of this bit of forest I've protected. But it depends on somebody else's decisions that that's true. And, you know, whereas if you put carbon dioxide underground and you monitor it and you make sure it's staying there, you're not relying on, okay, you're relying on somebody else not coming and drilling a hole and extracting that carbon dioxide in 100 years' time. Yes, but then that's starting to get a bit perverse if people were to start to do that. So I think it's, you know, that's the distinction we need to draw.
Anybody else in the room? Yep.
Trevor Murdoch from Canadian Center for Climate Services. And we are often dealing with users who want for adaptation planning towards the end of the century, sort of picking which scenario are we going to hit. So, you know, you talked about the different RCPs being unrealistic, and you know the whole talk is about a massive policy that needs to be taken up to get to hit net zero. So, if you were to bet, how this would affect if you're planning something for the end of the century for adaptation, assuming your most likely case scenario that happens with CCS, how would that affect which level of global warming you'd plan for towards the end of the century?
Well, I mean, this is where, optimistically, if we cracked on with this, and Andrew's laughing already, stabilizing below 1.5, I think, that's not looking promising, okay? But between 1.5 and 2 would be entirely achievable. Obviously, it depends on Earth system feedbacks and, you know, things we don't know about. But, you know, even if we got down to geological net zero in the sort of 2070, 2080 or so, that would still be, if we start now getting on this, then we'd be able to limit the warming to below 2. I do think the line, oh, it's all hopeless, we'll just have to adapt to a 4-degree world, which we're increasingly hearing in Europe, I think is incredibly misleading and incredibly damaging. So this is a solvable problem. Not a completely solvable problem, because 2 degrees of warming will suck for a lot of things. But, you know, we can meet the 2-degree goal.
We're going to do one last question over here to Tamara.
Hi, I'm Tamara. I'm a policy prof, and so I appreciate that governments can and should do things. They can be very effective. You've been paying attention to this issue for a long time. To end on a positive note, what have you found? What are you most optimistic about? Or what have you seen that you really, feel is impactful today?
Things can change fast. None of us saw the Paris Agreement coming. I mean, I think that's fair. In the academic community, it really blindsided me. It's like, whoa, that was really ambitious. So when things come together, things can change pretty fast. The industry, the fossil fuel industry, has the capacity to do stuff on a colossal scale really fast. And you've only got to look at the fracking revolution to see that. So with the right incentives, if enough people start to realize this is what's going to have to happen, the juggernaut could change direction pretty quickly. But what we need is the sort of voices of climate that are out there who never seem to be climate scientists. They're sort of ex-diplomats or, you know, general sort of trusted voices of one form or another. But we need them to start making it this simple and not just saying, oh, we have to do everything, which is not a very helpful thing to say because it doesn't tell people what they actually have to do. So, you know, I've never heard any of the sort of client, and I've tried. I've argued. I'm not going to call out names here, but I've tried to present. You know, why don't you say we've got to stop fossil fuels from causing global warming before the world stops using fossil fuels? You know, they accept that that's true, but they won't say it. I think we need more people out there saying this to the public, so the public gets it. Yes, it does mean we will be using fossil fuels beyond the date of net zero. Let's get our mind around that and work out how to do it.
Let's give a round of applause for Myles Allen. And just a little hospitality. We know you're traveling, so we don't want to send you away with a big package, but we've got some kind of island treats here for you and your family. And so thank you very much.
Okay.
And just to kind of finish things off, we want to invite Francis Zwiers, the director of PKIC, up to say some final words. And thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Myles, for a really fantastic talk. And ending in such an upbeat way. I'm certainly often not as optimistic as you are.
I said we can do it. I didn't say we.
I understand. I've known Myles for a very long time. We spent enough really late evenings in these IPCC negotiating sessions, so I thank you for reminding me of that. Myles' stamina is incredible. You've seen this man give this absolutely brilliant talk. He's not betraying the fact that he must be suffering from 9 hours of jet lag or 8 hours of jet lag at the moment. But it is a very short trip that you're on to the West Coast, and so jet lag must be making its presence known in your life just as I'm speaking. So thank you again very much, Myles. It's really fantastic to see you here and to hear you speak.
Thank you.